Hi, this is Max. Today is December 8, 2016, and I continue my dictations about the idea of moving around. First, I have announcements. You can find us on humancolony.org. Join us on Facebook at Hucolo, H-U-C-O-L-O, which stays for Human Colony. Search for Hucolo on Facebook and search for Hucolo, H-U-C-O-L-O, at YouTube. Find our Hucolo TV YouTube channel. My friends, I invite helpers to run the webinars, to press buttons and to moderate. Also, I invite people to help with the conversion of our webinars into an internet radio and also into podcasts. We invite donations to pay for Jim's monitors. Send the money to me at max@human.colony.org via PayPal. And I invite your feedback in comments to this video, and also send your comments and sharings to max@humancolony.org. So why moving? Basically, when negative things happen in politics and economy, moving could be the wisest choice. Why would we expect negative things in politics and economy? Because it's kind of already started. You can see the first dominoes has fallen. Now it's December 2016. And good news, I think, it's my guess so far, but kind of intuitive guess, is that the doomsday has been canceled. The global crash of economy has been canceled. We shifted to a new timeline where one big crash will be replaced with many small bumps, smaller bumps. The bumps might still feel big, but not global. So I don't think it will be a global crash of economy with no light everywhere. I think it will be pockets of disasters here and there, but it wouldn't be at the same time in all places. So it wouldn't be that bad. So in this case, moving, even temporary move, would be advisable, would be smart. And also, it doesn't have to be territorial move. You don't really need to move in the space. Maybe you just need to change your jobs. Change your business. So changing the ways of life. So instead of moving in the space and moving other ways, you might move inside, you might change yourself and adapt to the new situations, and that could be sufficient. So the time now resembles very much what I have experienced in Russia in 30 years ago, in the time of perestroika, a big transformation of Soviet Union in 1980s and early 90s. In 87 I was 23 years old, and I just married, and I needed to find a place to live with my wife. You might realize the market of the living wasn't there. Well, you can't really find anything for any price. Moscow was terribly overpopulated. People lived, for many families, in one small tiny apartment. And also, I didn't have money to rent, so I had barely enough, it's called stipend, tiny money from science for the food. That was about it. So maybe it wasn't very smart to marry, but we got two wonderful children from that marriage, so it was worth it, and we had great time. So my apartment was overpopulated. I had big brother, younger brother, but still he was a teenager in the same room as I, and two parents, and into two tiny bedroom in Moscow in a big brick build a big concrete building. The whole Moscow is concrete. So My wife had two rooms, I guess. You can't call it bedrooms. She had one bedroom, but, you know, the living room was also usable. But my mother-in-law gave us a lot of trouble. She was for the marriage in some way, but very jealous in many other ways. So it was near disaster. She was kind of all making, you know, everything difficult. And we adapted as much as we could. But it's just difficult. So we were looking for ways to escape that. You know, any place, any livable place would do for us. And I just remembered that my uncle would have possibly an apartment. I don't know how I remember it. It's just, now it's like 30 years later, I don't remember. But there was, maybe I just asked for no reason, maybe I asked for a reason, but the problem is that, you know, I disliked the uncle, and I was afraid of him from the childhood, from being very tiny, and he would be too loud. Yeah, he always was too loud, but otherwise he loved me. So that kind of one-sided blockage was something on the way. But when I started communicating to him, especially after my mother died later in 94, he became basically the father figure in my life, and he was wonderful and very helpful in many ways. So basically, I realized he is very much like I, and he just loved and helped in many ways. So that barrier was on my side, it was in my mind, and coming over it was a challenge, but, you know, there was a door which opened just like that. So he had an empty room somewhere in the middle of nowhere. You had to take a train, electric train, and but practically it was okay, it was usable. So my wife and I moved there, and that was a huge event for 22 years old, just to move to the apartment, to a room in a joint apartment, and live by themselves. We did great, we learned a lot, you know, we barely knew how to cook, barely knew how to, you know, do stuff. So for us it was a big move, and it was a happy move. It was very cold winter. 87 was very cold, right? You had to walk and had to train, and it was dark, but it was happy, actually. It was happy, it was interesting. You know, at that time, I didn't realize that you got to be tough. Really, I was the one who wanted to make everyone happy. I'm still the one who wants to make everyone happy, but I kind of learned a little bit. At that time, I had no clue. Nobody told me that you got to be tough. It was my take on the way of life that, you know, everyone is tough around and I'm not. I will adapt to everyone. I will smile to everyone. I will try to make friends with everyone. Kind of irrational, but that's how it is. So the neighbors, I tried to smile to them. I tried to communicate to them, but they just wanted us out. They had two bedroom to their own, and now we moved in. And although we tried to be quiet and not to be on their way, that it still wasn't enough. So finally, they filed a claim to the police, and a policeman came and he spoke to us. And at that time, again, I wasn't tough enough, and I was so afraid of bureaucracy, so I just kind of, whatever, let's move on. And we left. But nowadays, you know, obviously, if I consulted with friends and stuff, maybe I would figure something out. But maybe the legalities weren't perfect, but there were ways around. And in Soviet Union, there are always ways around to clear things up. Clearly, my uncle owned that room, so there should have been some arrangement so we could rent it. So the take-home message I wanted to just emphasize. Living with your friends and relatives is a great option. Now I see in San Diego, the expense here for the rent is so expensive. It's like three times more expensive than, maybe four times more expensive than in normal places. So people especially light workers, especially enlightened people, they just are moved together. So typically someone gets divorced, right? They keep the house for some reason, for maybe it's economically efficient, and then they move, allow people to move for free to their house and just maybe chip in a little bit for payment. So people leave like 3, 4, 5 families of light workers in one house, and that's great. They form a commune, they help each other, and they share the costs. It's efficient, really. Living together is very efficient in many ways. You just need to have good housekeeping habits, and because the density is higher, there is a higher chance of getting infection just from the flus and stuff. So you might, you know, make sure you're good with antibiotics and stuff. You know, just antibiotics is sufficient. So when you get an infection and it goes pretty bad, then you got to use antibiotics. There is usually, in dense population, there is not much more you can do. But other than that, living together is great. You also need room for meditation, but how much room do you need? You can go out, you can just lock yourself in a small room, and that should be sufficient. And using noise-blocking earmuffs is a great help. So my family always lives in smaller apartments, smaller areas. It's more economical, and you just put on earmuffs and you don't hear anything. So you're on your own. So the noises is, I guess, I'm sensitive to noises. So earmuffs just for normal life, for work, for meditation, for everything. You take them off to communicate, and then you meditate and concentrate on your work. Just put earmuffs. I just buy them on Amazon. They're about $25 or hardware store for woodworkers. 3M, you don't need very fancy, you just need like the basic ones, and make sure they're comfortable in your head. The 3M earmuffs, they have metal spring to push the earpieces to your head, so you can safely adjust it, you can kind of bend it to a little anti so they don't push too hard, and not too little, not too hard, and that's a great tool to live in densely populated apartments. Next story about the move, I guess it's classical, you have to mention it. It's Babylonian exile. Right. So the Jews in Israel had two temples, and where temples were conquered and destroyed, these were two most tragic events in Jewish history in the past, and it was on the same day of Yom Kippur. Some Jews fought against the enemies and were basically destroyed, and some Jews accepted the exile to Babylon, now Persia and Iraq. So later Persia, later Iraq, and this was foreign culture for them, but it allowed them to be there. It allowed them to be there, allowed them to... The host countries usually prefer that Jews would assimilate, and many did. So those that did, they just did assimilate, they took the new faith, and we don't know much more about them because they disappeared. And those who kept the tradition, we know about them because, they kept the tradition to this day. So Babylonian exile is a big tragedy in Jewish history, but also it is one of the events which influenced all modern world. It was a time when Jews made their religion, our religion, portable. Most of religions, I guess all other religions, no, most of the ancient religions are attached to the land. Attached to the land, like Russians. They are attached to their places. Roman religion, all religion is attached to the certain place. And it's attached also not only to the land, but also to the people. Christianity went beyond that. But But until Christianity went beyond, there was no world religions. It was, I guess it, yeah, Christianity was first to become a world religion because it went beyond the national borders. But Jewish Old Testament religion became portable in a way that wherever Jewish people went, they took it with it. So first exile, I guess one of the exiles, Jewish people had many exiles. One of the biggest exiles was Babylonian exile. Another exile was the exodus from Egypt, right? Also, Jews kind of were, just went with their religion. They carried something with them. It could be more than scriptures, but they carried something with them and they made it portable. So, and it is a religion of one God, which is universal, basically. That is, the law of one and the idea of one God is permeating the galaxy. So this was essential that the Jews kept it, and also then later they give it to the world through Jesus. Basically, the idea of one God was delocalized by Jesus, right? You forget about it, but that's what he did. In addition to making God kind, so Jewish God wasn't kind, it was everything, but it was good and evil in the same idea. In Jesus's teaching, God became kind, and it was delocalized. It was took away from only Jews and was given to the world. And that transformed the world. That created the modern world. Even Muslims also took it from Christians. So on practical terms, the move of the Jews into Babylon was keeping the faith was a lesson that sometimes you can't fight. You know, if you fight, you get destroyed and forcibly assimilated. If you move on, you still can keep your faith and wait for the time, maybe generations, until you come back to the homeland. And for Jews, it was a few thousand years, right? For a few thousand years, the Jews were away from Israel, the land of milk and honey, and then 1948, they got it back. It's romantic. From Jewish perspective, it's very romantic. And also, it is very mystical. Basically, you got a promise, and then the promise became a reality through your hands, through your own hands. You got the promise, and then you realize this promise by yourself. Basically, you just believe, you get a faith, and you carry it through, and then at a certain point, the promise through your hands, through your own actions, becomes reality, and you get back your land, you get back your state, you get back, you recollect, you reunite the people again. People were dispersed, moved out, and then they reunited. So a lot of lessons here. One of the essential properties of the move, one of the essential benefits of the move is that it allows you to rediscover yourself, you change, and also it allows you to remain sane. Very often, where you are, you become depressed. And just moving out refreshes the energies, flushes the energies. So it is a great tool to stay sane, especially in those times when things become difficult and scary. Moving, even temporarily traveling, helps you to regain your sanity, regain your balance. That's one thing. And the example is, say again, coming back to my memories, 1988 to 1994. Yes, the whole world crashes, the big economy of the country falls apart. It was inflation, people, banks closed. There was like few banks. First they opened, then people made a lot of money, and then they closed. There was a big crash of the economy. the factories close, the jobs remain, some remain, but the money they pay are worthless. You just don't pick up the salary because it is absolutely worthless. You might still go to jobs just because you feel it's your identity. You need something to do, and also that you get certain benefits without money for going to a job. It sounds funny, right? So, as a scientist, I went to my job not as often, but I would still come to the lab, I still do experiments, and that helped me to get my PhD without being paid, and to get your and to move to America, basically. I actually started, we invented something, and that invention allowed me to move to America. So the job was more like a hobby. You would get a living from some other random sources. You would do certain works to get a living, but then you would go to the lab and do the work as science work as hobby. Sounds crazy, but in larger perspective, it makes sense. That's what we do with light working, right? You come here to human colony as a hobby, or maybe, I don't know. You don't make money here, right? You don't make money here. Come here. I guess Jim is the only one who makes money from channeling. That's his lineage. Until you become a professional channeler, you come here as a hobby. You just, because you believe in it. That's your highest excitement. And then you go elsewhere and make your living from something else, which is less, often less, lower vibrational. So in this time, the first sign of the decay was tons of poor people. Second sign, people start, because, you know, people become so poor, they just, nice people of higher classes are so desperate, they would take whatever they have, stand on the street and try to sell it, because they need the food to eat. So, especially certain places like marketplaces were spontaneously formed on convenient spots like intersections, near railroad stations, bus stations. Just, you know, some places became known for being markets. And early on, the police was trying to remove those, and, you know, they were bribed. And then the city, Moscow city government, allowed those, permitted those gatherings. Then they started kind of, after a few years, they started to organize them, give them tables and charge for tables, for just for tables and for little kiosks and tents and so on. And then at some point they just move everybody inside, so they allowed only registered traders, only in registered buildings, nothing temporary. And at some point they completely removed temporary kiosks. There was nothing movable. You can't really even put a, you know, the movable house, the movable kiosk and sell stuff. They were like completely got rid of any kiosks, which was like too much. Obviously too much. But why would government do that? Because it allows them to monopolize everything and tax everything. Yeah, taxing. So it was largely evil, obviously, largely selfish. It slowed down the exchange. It pushed out most of the small traders from the business. So only established traders would trade. And it largely reduced the variety. Basically, people couldn't sell stuff. Only approved varieties were allowed. So in the early days of the transformation, you can buy anything, you can sell anything, including, I think, drugs. I never saw drugs sold, so I never saw them, and I never saw drugs sold, but I assumed the drugs like entered the market at that time. But everything else was there. And now it is and lots of different varieties. The varieties came from, you know, food, like for example, food was obviously cheaper on the street. You would have to be an expert in the food quality, right? It sounds scary, but I guess many countries still live in that. How do you call it? So many countries still live in this lifestyle and this economy style. True free market, true markets, true people coming and selling stuff. People selling on the streets and peddlers selling on the streets. It's natural. There are some negative sides to that, obviously, but the trade kind of goes up in many ways. And the convenience of that, having market near your home, you don't have to go far. And you know in person, you can speak to the people who get it. So basically, I remember after, like in Soviet Union, we had very standardized food, very poor quality food. Standardized wine, very poor quality wine. And in these years of true free market, amazing cheap food came out, amazing. And amazing wines came out. So the main principle was you look around, you try, you experiment, explore, and finally when you find a gold mine, find something good for a good price, you stock as much as you can. Stocking was like an art in Russia. You would stock stuff in all years, especially in hard years. And then you would keep coming back to that place, and you know that the qualities of that product. So I found amazing red wine. I never tried it. I never found such good wine again. In big jars, like 2 gallon jars, 2 gallon glass jars, and I stocked it up, and we kept buying it. It was so good. It's just hard to describe. Yeah, I guess now wine lovers also have this that sort of hunting, exploration, tasting exercise. They go in different wineries and they try everything possible, and then when they find something, they get a stick to it. So that works not only with wine, that works with everything in hard times. Just to survive, you have to find good food, which is healthy for you, even now. And stick to it, and then keep exploring and finding even better ones, and keep exploring and finding more needed things. And even more than produce, you need to find information. Finding information is absolutely essential, basically. When to move and where to move. And move in terms of location, also move in terms of jobs and businesses. So for some people and from some stages of life, it's better to be employed and get experience. And for some ages, stages of life and situations and people, it is better to work for yourself. Maybe you don't make as much, but you don't have bosses, you don't have to adjust to others. It gives you tons more opportunities for spiritual growth, for meditation and contemplation. Basically, some people feel fine working certain specific hours and going outside of their home to work. And for some people, it is a torture, right? It is really, you know, if it rises your vibration, if it keeps you sane, if it keeps you company, if it pays in many other ways, if it gives you experience, right? Going to work is great, but if it lowers your vibration, if the experience which you get is trivial, if it lowers your experience, prevents you learning lessons, then doing your own business might be better. Of course, there are some people who go in low vibration either way, right? Some people are just not suited for either one. So yeah, of course, it's all kind of trading negative versus negative, right? Sometimes, and sometimes positive versus positive. And anyway, I was dragged by my spirit guides, by the circumstances from one job to another. On average, I would say I change jobs more frequently than others, maybe 10 times more frequently. So I worked on 100 jobs and 100 projects, different projects, and every time, I guess I was stupid enough, but I already knew that it could be temporary, but I would still engage in it full time, full force, full mental force. I would melt into it. How do you call it? Just grew into it. I would fully, as Aquarius, as a air sign, I would explore it to the full capacity. So it was every job, every business I would take as a lesson, and I would kind of transform into it. And if you do it too often, it drives you crazy, right? You lose your identity, you lose your integrity. So you know, sometimes it happens, often you're like, you're desperate, like, right? Often you're desperate and you engage in this sort of job, say, science, and you transform into your science form, spiritually. Yeah, spiritually transform, you kind of vibrate as a scientist. You get into scientist vibration. And you write job applications and bother your potential employers in every other way, like through network of friends. Nowadays it would be through LinkedIn and Facebook. And then you come up with a new idea and a new opportunity, and you go into some other non-science money-making mode, and that drives you crazy, right? Because like several times a day, switching from one mode to another is just unhealthy. It is unhealthy. You can't really, until you get used to this transformation, until you become, make it periodic, you lose your identity. Are you a scientist or, say, a startup businessman or a physical worker or a salesperson and so on? So that understanding, that realization, you can't really be everything at the same time. I don't know. For some people, it might be obvious. And for some people, it takes years to transform. For me, it takes hours or maybe days. But being at the same day several times, this different thing is hard. Because, okay, let me explain. It would help you too. I'm not talking about only about myself. But I am an air sign. And as an air sign, I'm changing as a whole. So when I'm transforming from one thing, and as I shapeshift from a scientist, say, to a salesperson, I change as a whole. There is very little left in me which is crystallized. It's the whole pattern of vortexes of my spirit, even of my body, is realigned. So I'm changing. I'm fully transformed. I'm using, some people use 10% of their brain. I'm using 100% of my brain, 100% of my heart, 100% of my stomach. I'm thinking with every part of my body. I'm embodying the thing I'm channeling with every part of my body. That's the way I'm designed. So for some people, lying is easy because they're so fragmented, they have lots of separations and they can switch from one identity to another very easily. And I can't, I really can't. I can transform like an actor, I can shapeshift in a new spirit, but it takes effort and it's not momentous. It takes not fast. It takes, I guess it takes a sleep, at least a sleep or several days or a meditation. So it is not that easy. So is my thinking. I think in an intuitive way and it is very diffused. So I sometimes it takes like a meditation to get certain idea. When an idea comes digital, then I kind of can formulate it as words or as an answer. But the process of thinking is not digital. The process of thinking is wave shaped. It is resonation shaped. So basically what I do, many people do that, many people, it's intuitive. What I do is to send a wave to all parts of my body and all parts of my psychic, asking a question, and then like a channeler does, intuitively wait for an answer to come back in form of understanding, not even words, just understanding. So that's my main mode of thinking. And tons of other people, most of other people, not everybody, but bigger portion of other people think digitally. Some people think with words, some people think with other digital constructs. When I say digital, I don't mean numbers, I mean binary. I mean yes, no, or discrete. It would be more discrete in terms of I actually don't know the word, but it would be discrete number of choices, switching between 1, 2, 3, 4. So if this is there, then logically it would be that, that, or that, and then logically it would be that, or none of the above. So that is way faster. It really works great for fighters when you really have to react fast. Not necessarily, but it works great anyway. And it allows you to process much more information. So people, I know for sure, another air sign, Gemini. I met Gemini, which think largely through, as I call, digitally. They can store tons of information and process tons and tons of information without harming themselves. So when you need to process large amount of information without actually understanding much, digital thinking is great. But for certain things, for discoveries, for exploring unknown, you still have so much so little information, so little understanding, you really have to go intuitive. So that's where thinking of the wave, diffuse thinking, like wave, intuitive thinking, I say works better. So obviously I use both, you use both, everybody uses both. It's called corpuscular, I guess, which means quantum thinking. Quantum meaning in terms of small units of knowledge, small units, discrete units of knowledge versus wave-shaped, intuitive, non-discrete, fluid thinking. So for people who are more discrete, it's easier to switch, easier to lie, easier to block things. They can multitask easier, they can kind of digitally switch. And for people who have to transform the whole soul, the whole body for the new task, it's really hard to multitask, really hard to switch into different modes, different shapes at the same time. It takes time, but then they can shape shift and they can really transform much on a much deeper level. Right, so that's coming back to the idea of moving, right? So hard times. Moscow is in a complete disaster, you know, the whole country is in a complete disaster. And at home, you know, it's packed with people who are who feel that energy. So you have to escape. So escaping from that madness, from that depression, collective depression at home and basically in the country was essential. How do you escape? There are, of course, you know, every one of you is an expert in escaping mentally and keeping yourself safe. Now, most of you go and listen to Jim, right? That's the main escape. You listen to Bashar and it brings you back to sanity. Yeah, listening to Jim and Bashar brings you to sanity. Other options, yeah, audiobooks. Now we have, I go through my depressions and they're frequent now. Not deep, but frequent. I go using audiobooks and I have my favorites, which kind of bring me to the certain mood really well. There's certain music and certain audiobooks. And now it's so easy, just press a button and you immerse yourself for a couple days in certain audiobook and you come back to sanity. My favorite is Yes Minister, Yes Prime Minister by BBC. When I need to deal with bureaucracy, when I need to be less afraid of bureaucracy and of so-called cabal and so-called administration, then Yes Minister is a vaccine. It works miracles. You really understand how they function, you become part of them, and you take it easy. You just realize who they are, how they work, it becomes transparent, all becomes transparent to you. So if you're afraid of cabal, Yes Minister is a prescription. And it is also on video, and both video and audio are great. and Audible has it. So buy it on Audible for about $15. You will not be afraid of Kabbalah anymore. You just listen to that thing. At that time, we had also things to listen, and it was not as plenty, but it was profound. Profound listening. It was songs, and songs, I would say, it's not the same musical style, but the same idea as Bob Dylan, lots, and Leonard Cohen, lots of words. I guess it's Jewish, both are Jewish, right? Lots of words, lots of wisdom, and lots of new solutions. And for that, for us, it was also Jews and half Jews. It's kind of, what is half Jew for you, right? Half Jew, it means in Russia, it's counted really precise. It's Jewish father, Russian mother, or Jewish parent and non-Jewish parent. So my favorites, they all three were, I think, all three of them were half Jews, and I'm half Jew. So so it was Galich, Akudjava, Vysotsky, and Mandelstam. Actually, Mandelstam, I think, was more than half. And many more, but basically you listen, and that brings you back. And also we listened to foreign radios, which were blocked in large extent, but there were several dedicated radios of Russian immigrants who would explain to you what is happening from the outside perspective, and it was invaluable. And Radio Liberty found a beautiful voice of compassion. Beautiful, sad voice of compassion, which you can't hear anywhere else. You couldn't, even in church, there was nobody else. Maybe in the theater, maybe a little bit. But Radio Liberty gave us that emotion. No matter what they spoke about, they gave us the word of compassion, the sound of compassion, and it was absolutely real. It was amazing. That was what we needed. That is what we needed. Compassion from outside. And they gave us that. And people who worked there, they were our heroes. They were great. Then there was a radio which formed in early stages of the transformation. I would say maybe early 90, I think maybe around 1989. It was called the Echo of Moscow. It was called the Echo of Moscow. Makes no sense, but anyway, we call it Echo. And they also got wonderful voice. And they also get the voice of freedom. They laughed on radio. They just made spontaneous jokes, which was something new for the radio. For the Soviet Union, it was unthinkable. For many countries in the world, it's still unthinkable, say for Turkey and stuff like that. They laughed and they joked and they were free. And in hard days, there was a gentleman, a radio speaker, commentator, it's called commentator, I guess. Yeah, commentator. He was making, I guess, 1 minute, yeah, it was 1 minute speeches, like really short ones. But they were so profound. So during the times of the choice, during the times of hugest transformation, once a day, he would give us one-minute speeches. His name was Andrei Cherkizov. And that was, I guess, the most profound thing that kept us sane and kept us whole. Yeah, there was a voice. It was like voice of God. It was the wisest voice which was heard around. It was very concise. It was like channeling, condensed channeling. He gave us the hope, the idea, the understanding, and the connection. So that is about listening. Now, reading, of course, favorite books. Many Russians still keep tons of books on their shelves. I move with the favorite books. I didn't trash them yet. When I first moved to America, it was boxes and boxes of books which I mailed from Russia. Now I let them go because, you know, I can't read them anymore. But the favorite ones, I still read them. And then moving out, like I remember complete depression. My kids are small, the food is scarce, the winter is dark, like in Russia, in Moscow, winter is Winter nights are long. It's way north of America. It's like America doesn't have, I guess, Alaska. It would be, correspond to Alaska. Most of the day is dark, and then there are a few hours of light. And that light is also through the clouds in Moscow. So pretty dark, pretty depressing. The kids are unhappy and crying. And there is not much you can do. And my wife is, you know, working at the work and getting money. And sometimes she would work nights, some night shifts, or sometimes evening shifts. So what do? I was very good with hiking and tourist stuff. I guess now we could call it cop-outs or something. So I grabbed the kids, grabbed the sleds, and it is evening. Why was it evening? I don't know. It just happened that, you know, the darkness was hardest in the evening. And we take a train to the closest forest. In Moscow, there is not much forest, so you have to take a train, like, how do you call it? A trolley train, a local train. And we exit at the station, and I just put them on a sled in the cold. It was not too cold, but cold enough. Year was it? Around 90, maybe? No, it was not 90. It was 92, I guess. 92. One child is like 2 years old, another is like 4 years old. I put them both in a sled. We get in the forest, and I make a fire right by the sled trail, a skiing trail. And that was happy. That was wonderful. You make a fire in at night, and it's warm, and then you go back. Now, going back wasn't that easy, but basically we burned the fear out. We burned the depression out. We connected to the nature in this weird way at night. In the you just escaped from Moscow, right? At night to the nature, and it worked miracle. So, you know, if nothing works, if you're depressed, go to the nature, make a fire. Okay. In California, you can't make a fire because you can make a forest fire. But in the other places, yeah, we always find the places where you can make a legal fire and not to be caught. Yeah. In Maryland, in upstate New York, in Illinois. In the times when it is safe, you would find places like grills. You find a grill and make a fire on a grill. You find a campground which is closed at winter and make a fire on a grill in the campground. So that trick worked, even in America. And making a fire has shamanic significance. Use it often. Nowadays, we go to the beach, bring a fire pit with us, and make a fire in a legal way by the beach, and it's not dangerous for the nature, and it is healing. You have the waves of the ocean and the fire, and it works great. And the kids love it. Kids love the energy. So, going to the nature often, like my friend was saying, you know, I love to go to the forest and just speak to it. He would walk days and days in the forest. And other nature is great, but there is something about that area of forests, how do you call it? Northern forests, just the forests, yeah. There is something about the forests, something very magic. Being in the forest is very healing. In the summer, in the hot summer, the forest is not as hot. In the cold winter, the forest is not as cold. Being in the forest is tremendous. So going to the parks and forests and just communicating to them it keeps you sane. And there is some magic connection between humans and trees. So it's not simply like you go to something foreign. No, when you are in a forest, you are in another shape of humanity. It's just the same humanity, just in a different shape, in a different times, speed of time, but it is part of you too. So forest is something you need for sanity in hard times. And the next thing was museums. Moscow, as bad as it was, had museums, and the museums functioned all the time. I mean, in due hours. But going to the museums was a big escape, and something wasn't pronounced yet as words, as text, but there were artistic exhibitions which served for the release and for the transformation. So much of transformation happened on artistic side, and I was part of it. I was with the artist, I was doing art myself, and that helped me to transform. It works more on subconscious emotional level, but the transformation done by art is great. So paintings, movie art, but paintings mainly, like, were a big part, music and painting. So in Russia, at the time of hard times, right, the artists just went to the streets and was selling their new paintings on the street. And initially it was meaningful art, it was unique art, absolutely unique. And it was the art which reflected the reality. It could be realistic, it could be non-realistic, it could be historical, but it was a reflection of reality and transformation of that reality. So it was just, you go to the art exhibition on the street where people in different times of weather would, like in the winter, in the summer, in the heat, under the rain, they would cover the art with plastic. They were showing their art and selling their art. And they would paint. Wonderful painters were working on the streets. They're still working on the streets. The quality went down, but they were amazing, amazing, talented artists working on the street, just making portraits. And by itself, it was a transformation. If you have a chance, find a good artist and have a portrait done of you. And it's also a mystical work. I mean, if a good artist does it, it is a transformative work. It finds new you. So for us, escaping into art galleries and finding answers there, doing the transformation work there, was huge. I don't know, many of you don't live in a places with art galleries, but some of you do live in a places with art galleries, but consider using them. Not all of them are good. So like art galleries in Rochester, I actively hate it. Rochester is like Denver, like Albuquerque, has lots of darkness, lots of artistic darkness. The art there is transformative in the negative side. It is more like the art of Cabal, their symbol. Yeah. The Eastman Kodak art galleries are terrible. They are negative. There is a condensed negative energy in art. Well, they are talented, just negative. Condensed negative vibration, condensed vibration of the destruction. Similar things I have relationship with some of the modern art museums. So now I find the art, the good art on DeviantArt, Flickr. Yeah, DeviantArt and Flickr. If you just search, and also, yeah, one great place, Printerest. Printerest, I guess, is more conducive for a collection of Lightworker art. Just search for angels, and from there, it's easy to explore and make your art collection. So, this is... I spend tons of time and get tons of fun these days just collecting art on Printerest. And then I print it out. It's very cheap. On Amazon, one print is like maybe under 10 cents per print. So you can download, print it on Amazon, and post it on your wall. And then you have angels and whatever you want, Merkabas, mandalas on your wall, giving you ascended masters, giving you visual connection. Reminders, so they help to shape your mind, and also they carry the vibration. So with this, I conclude my today's dictation. So just to wrap up, I was speaking about the ability to move, be mobile, locally and physically, physically and psychologically, and about how to stay sane and transform according to reality. So my prediction, my understanding, which is kind of obvious now, is that we are up to hard times, but they wouldn't be very hard. It would be like localized hard times, local, spotty, there'll be a lot of transformations, up and down, a bumpy ride. So you might choose to be flexible, might choose to adapt fast, might choose to serve and learn the lessons. And I hope that my stories of my past going through similar hardships and similar hard times would help you. Basically, just connect to this idea of exploration and lessons and simple tricks which help you to stay afloat while going through that. And basically, some of you would be just observers, so you just need to survive, that's all. And some of you would be active participants and transformers, doers. Some of you will be doers who would do something and help the transition. See the big picture, see that it is needed. It's the only way the change can be done. We need to release a lot of stuff. We need to develop new stuff and dump the old one. So that would be coincide with changes. So you take it neutrally, take it just so that something is needed, and it is a collective choice. So basically the whole collective is pushed by whatever divine logic, divine laws, is pushed to that transformation. We are making this shift to ascension. So take it with a perspective of divine wisdom and understand things are played out in a Давай заходи быстрее. Ну заходи, кот, быстрее, проходи. Things are developed in a divine wisdom and guidance. These dictations I publish unedited, so it was funny how you heard Russians. I basically finished my walk with dogs, and it was wonderful morning with lots of sun in San Diego, and the cat tried to escape, so I had to convince the cat to stay at home while asking the dogs to come faster through the door so the cat wouldn't jump out. And they understand only speaking, you can't really silently communicate to them. At least not that quickly. So I'll repeat the announcements. I invite your comments here in comments under the video. I invite your comments and messages at max@humancolony.org. Don't promise that I will answer, but at least I will read. I'll try to answer. If you need my answer, just keep writing. Some days I get tons of messages and I can't answer everything, but I read everything. We invite donations for gym monitor. Send the money by PayPal to max@humancolony.org. I invite helpers for pressing buttons and moderation on the webinars, especially my webinars on Sundays. I would like to have more help there as I channel. And invite someone to take charge of the project to convert our videos to an internet radio. It should be free. Or if needed to pay, we can pay a little bit for the registration and stuff. And for conversion our videos into audio podcasts, so people can listen through their internet radio and podcast applications, which takes less bandwidth and it's easy to listen and through your smartphone. And also invite more helpers with Slava is doing a great job, but nowadays he got a job, so it's harder for him to help. So invite helpers with video editing. Basically, to make these videos, I would have to do some editing. If somebody can take care of that, it would be nice. All right, I will continue later. Thank you very much for listening to this very end, or scrolling to this very end, and have a good day. Talk to you later. I bless you all. Ham hanna 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 ora hanna yalla ham hanna o maya ora na o maya ora na ora hanna ya ora yanna hanna ya ama o kata da ya kata da ya o kata ra no o taka ana ya o ta ya o ana ya ta a ta ya o ka ama hala. Breathe. Bite. breathe, feel illusion of the physical reality. Feel the bliss, feel the beauty, understand opportunity to learn lessons and to help this reality to transform to a better one. Be a gardener. Garden yourself and garden the illusionary reality, the dream reality outside of you. Together with your friends, you can help the transformation. You can help the ascension. You can help creating of the new world.